We think we're going to start. We're of course crowded, which in one way is a good problem to have. On the other hand, it's a bad problem to have. But hopefully all of you are here are going to find this a very worthwhile evening. We're going to actually begin with some music from folk singer Judy Borman. Many of you have probably heard Judy before. I just said to you, I actually heard her when I was 15 years old. I think she might have been the first folk singer I ever heard. She has actually performed for Broken for Peace off and on over the years, and every time she's done it, it's really been a great treat for all of us. Judy is an internationally known singer and songwriter. She's traveled around the world and in this country often with Pete Seeger. She has performed at the United Nations. She is somebody who is always willing to lend her voice to groups that are working for peace and social justice. So that's something to keep in mind. She also has her CDs here, which I would encourage folks to acquire at the end of the program. But we have a lot to do tonight, so it's really a great privilege to welcome Judy Borman to this Brooklyn for Peace event. Welcome, Judy.
course, is Leonard Cohen's great song, and for many years I could not bring myself to sing it because it's just the darkest song I know. But then I figured out a way to sing it. I had a revelation that as things get worse, my plan has been to get more and more optimistic out of sheer spite. Things I'm seeing, and I've been wondering about some things I heard. Everybody crying mercy when they don't know the meaning of words. Situations sure enough getting worse. Everybody crying just as long as there's business first. Toe-to-toe, touch and go, and it's give a cheer, get your own souvenir. You don't even have to turn on your TV to see something plain absurd. Everybody crying mercy when they don't know the meaning of the word. Look straight ahead and it's knock 'em dead. Oh yeah, it's pack your kit, choose your own hypocrite. Running round in circles, wondering what we are headed for. Everybody crying, peace on earth, just as soon as we win this war. Ahead, knock 'em dead. Pack your kit, choose your own hypocrite. You don't even have to turn on your TV to see something plain absurd. Everybody crying mercy when they don't know the meaning of words. Nobody knows the meaning of the mothers and fathers around the world, rear their children strong. Everyone in every land can sing a freedom song. Then we'll have peace. Then we'll have peace. Sing it to me. We'll have peace. Then we'll have peace. For peace is based on love and trust. Thus no man lives on man. Nor shall own their native soil, though it is ancient land. Peace is based on love and trust. Thus all shall be heard. Goodwill towards all and peace on earth. If there's a God, then that's the word. There shall be peace. There shall be peace. There shall be peace. So Pete, who I had the great honor to work with, used to say that music doesn't really change the world. Only people change the world. But sometimes, music changes people. And I'm sure it's changed many of the people in this room. So I encourage people, I mean this with all my heart, to sing more. To sing to yourselves, to sing to other people. For people who say, oh, you don't have a good voice, you can say, oh, thank you for sharing, and now you're not going to sing with me, why don't you shut up? No, really, I mean, if you think about it, you spend like 12 hard months learning to walk and talk, and then for 12 years they tell you to sit down and shut up. So it's very important that people talk up and learn and protest and sing. So here's a song. Thank you very much, and I want to give a big round of applause for the people at Brooklyn Peace who brought us all together.
None of us are free.
Thank you, Judy. And you're every bit as inspiring tonight as you've been over many decades. And all of us in the peace movement have a real debt to you for your willingness to perform on these occasions. And also, it's kind of a good thing to get some optimism in the room. I'm looking at the fire. I mean, I guess if Judy and Barack Obama could be cheerful, but I'm not sure how the rest of us will do. So just very quickly, I think everybody knows that this event is being co-sponsored by Brooklyn for Peace and also for Greenpeace. Brooklyn for Peace has been in the neighborhood, I think since now, 1984. I'm getting so senile, I don't remember when we were founded, but we've been working for peace and social justice. I think we felt when we were founded in the 80s that nothing could be worse than then, but so there it goes. And I just, most of you are familiar with our work. A lot of you have been participants in our projects over the years. In case you hadn't noticed, peace and justice have not been achieved yet, which means we can use all your help. So hopefully you're signing up and volunteering for things, and will work with us as we go along. I want to just mention very quickly that if you haven't done so, please sign our petition at the table. We also have CDs for Judy Gorman, and we also have this new book. Veronica, would you hold that up? Right. Phyllis has just done her, is this your 11th book, Phyllis? Is that really true? Her book on ISIS. After our program tonight, Phyllis has agreed to be here to sign for you, sell her books. I think you'll find it a very, very worthwhile little volume to, you know, to acquire. In thinking about what we're doing tonight, I was actually reflecting back on 2003, which was probably the time when Brooklyn for Peace grew most dramatically. And I guess even at the end of 2002, 2003, what pulled so many of us in was the thought that if the United States invaded Iraq, that bad things would result. And I remember, and I'm looking around, whatever, and I'm looking around at how many people would say to each other, even just in this room, oh my God, they're going to drive the car off the cliff. But I'm not sure, even in our, you know, most pessimistic state of mind, that we fully imagined the train of consequences that would flow from this disastrous decision. And we're still living with those consequences today. So for tonight, we are going to be talking about the whole range of problems involved with the new war in ISIS and Syria and Iraq and refugees, war. All these things, and our speakers are going to do it in a half an hour to get that all. So I do want to emphasize that the part of the focus tonight, or probably major focus, is U.S. foreign policy. That's really where we're, what we're addressing most. And also, how can we, as people here in the United States, how do we respond to the multiple crises that we're confronted now, which in many ways are much more complicated in terms of when we try to figure out, you know, our response. So in terms of the format tonight, I want to make sure this is all right. What I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce both of our speakers now. I think Phyllis will go first. Is that right? David Wildman will go second. Then we will stop. You then begin to hear frantic pleas for money from us. And then we will go into a Q&A and have an opportunity for people to ask questions, to discuss, and so forth, because obviously these are very complicated matters. I always find it really hard to introduce people I already knew in the first place, so I'm going to say the official things that are already on your flyer, which is that Phyllis directs the new international project at the Institute for Policy Studies. She's been a writer, an activist, an analyst, a fellow at the Transnational Institute. She's written 11 books. And David Wildman is Executive Director, Secretary for Human Rights and Justice with the General Board of Global, I tried to memorize this, I don't know why. Wait, do this one again. Executive Secretary for Human Rights and Justice with the General Board of Global Ministries of the United Methodist Church. That's like a mouthful. And he has traveled widely in the Middle East and in Afghanistan. He he's also written articles, he has written a book together with Phyllis. So now that I've listed these things that sound a little abstract, I want to say the important thing. These people are great. Okay, they are great. And it's a pleasure to introduce them. It's a pleasure to introduce them because I think of them as friends. Oh, cell phones. I'm sorry. I thought I was just screaming into the mic.
No, no.
Turn off your cell phones. Okay. Can I go back to the part about them being friends? Okay. I'm going back. They have simply been friends for Brooklyn for Peace. This is hardly the first time they've appeared at one of our events. What is wonderful about them is that they're thoughtful people, that I think that when they come and speak that we actually have the comforting sense that they know what they're talking about. At the same time, they're open to different points of view and have both, in both cases, been very, very active in building a peace movement over these many years. So it's actually, from my point of view, been a great privilege to get to work with both of them. And on behalf of Brooklyn for Peace, I want to welcome both of you to this podium, and we don't even have a podium. Let's just go first.
Can we do this sitting?
Yes.
Sure.
Yeah.
Does that work?
Should we meet the press?
Does that work? Meet the not press? Sorry.
So I want to thank Brooklyn for Peace and for Green for Peace. I got to say, walking over here, David and I both got lost. I used to live in Brooklyn. It doesn't look the same. Sorry, and we almost ended up in Fort Greene. So I'm just saying, it's like a whole new scene up there. But thank you for organizing this. I'm sorry there's not enough chairs, but I guess that's sort of a good thing. There are some chairs over here for all you guys over there. There's a little more space over there. So, yeah, I mean, people, yeah, there's two seats right here, there's a couple over there.
Also audio up front.
Yeah, so let's wait for a second and get people sitting, because it's really not fair. One more seat here.
Is that true that there's live streaming in the cafe?
Okay. Yeah.
And there's live streaming.
Live streaming right out there.
The volume doesn't work.
No, there's audio out front now. There is audio in the
room. The audio will be improved now.
No, it's out there now.
Okay. Everybody who can get a seat has a seat. So, Saturday, it turns out, is the 25th anniversary of the U.S. invasion of Iraq. Not in 2003, but in 1991. Remember that one? The one that lasted only a few weeks, very few U.S. casualties, so we didn't hear very much about the huge numbers of Iraqi casualties, and led to 12 years of crippling sanctions that led to the death of 500,000 children, etc., and in many ways set the stage for the next iteration of the crisis. How many of you have heard this meme that's out there? ISIS was started when Obama withdrew the troops from Iraq. I didn't say, did you believe it? I said, how many of you have heard it? Yeah. Come on, the rest of you are lying. You all heard it.
All my students have heard.
All your students have heard. Everybody's heard it, because it's like out there. Not true. I mean, you all know it. That's why you don't want to admit that you've heard it, because you know it's not true. ISIS history is not that complicated. It has a beginning. It doesn't yet have an end, unfortunately. But it has a beginning that was not in 2011 when Obama pulled out the troops. It was in 2004, in the first year of George Bush's occupation of Iraq, when the origins of ISIS, it was called something different, and there's, you know, it's gone through a lot of changes of names and changes of identity, but the organization that became the ISIS that we know and hate today was created in 2004 as one of many militias that were fighting against the US occupation and against the US-backed Shia-dominated sectarian government in Baghdad. In many ways, that can also be traced back to the war of 1991. So the history, when we look at the history of what is US policy in the region, we can't just start with today. We can't start with Obama's State of the Union speech last night. We can't start with any of these immediacies. We can't start with Bush after 9/11. We have to go back. We have to go back very far. But at least as far as 1991, when the Cold War is collapsing, George Bush Sr. makes a judgment that here's the way to show the world that with or without our Soviet sparring partner, we are still the superpower. What way do you do that? You don't have a press conference. You go to war. And that became the basis for going to war. So what we're facing today is a set of intersecting crises, intersecting global crises. This new war is what George Bush used to call it, the global war on terror, the GWAT. Obama, on his first day in office, said, we don't want to use that term. We would like to call it something a little more benign, so we're going to call it overseas contingency operations. Quite Orwellian. But the bottom line is, this is the continuation. This is global war on terror 2.0, if you will. And it's significant because it's very different in the nature of the war. It's a war, but it's not the same kind of war. We could go into all the analysis of counterterrorism versus counterinsurgency and Petraeus versus the other guys, but it's not about that. It's really about, are there massive numbers of US troops on the ground, which means if there are, there will be massive numbers of US casualties? Or do we outsource the casualties? Doing what they used to call during Vietnam, changing the color of the corpses, so that the people who die are Iraqis and Syrians and Afghans and Palestinians, and not Americans. So that's the choice of the nature of war. That means that we rely on small numbers of troops, relatively, still 10,000 or so in Afghanistan, about 3,000 in Iraq. Officially, there's about 50 special ops forces in Syria. We don't know how many are really there. Maybe they don't wear boots, so they don't count boots on the ground. They wear sneakers because they're special operations in CIA. We have no idea how many are there. But this is a global war, which, the U.S. is the dominant military force, but the horrific role being played by all the other military actors, from the regime in Damascus to the Iranians and the Russians to the Saudis and the Qataris and the Jordanians, all of them are making everything worse. Because at the end of the day, this new kind of war is also failing. Because the lesson that they haven't learned is that you can't bomb terrorism out of existence. You can only bomb people. You can bomb people, and sometimes you might even hit a terrorist. You might kill them. But that just creates more terrorism. You can't bomb terrorism out of existence. Terrorism survives wars, as we've seen. We have been at war against terrorism since 2001. And terrorism is thriving. People are not doing so well in those wars. Not in Iraq, not in Syria, not in the surrounding countries, not in Afghanistan, not anywhere. But you can't bomb that out of existence. It was interesting in the State of the Union the other night to hear President Obama recognize the degree to which people are so frightened by the threat of terrorism. And that terrific article in the New York Times this morning that sort of deconstructed this huge gap between the chances of actually being the victim of a terrorist attack for people in this country, which is one in something like 2.9 million, versus what people think is the fear of terrorism, which is massive. It's a huge divergence from reality. But then the article went on to say, but of course, the government can't challenge that. Well, that's our job as a movement. It's not our only job, but it's a big chunk of what we've got to do. We've got to educate people about what it means to say, yeah, could there ever be a terrorist attack? Yeah, there could be. There was one in North Carolina. No, I'm not getting to San Bernardino yet. There have been other terrorist attacks in this country, carried out by people who live and were raised and born in this country, carried out by white people, so they don't call it terrorism. And there's also terrorism like what happened in San Bernardino. So yeah, you can't stop every act of terror, particularly if people are prepared to die for it. You can make it a lot less likely. You can't necessarily stop every bit of it. But you can stop carrying out the actions that create terrorism. You all remember, looking around the room, most of you, not luckily, you guys are doing good at bringing in some younger people, not everybody will remember, but some of you, most of you, still a lot of work to do, most of you will remember right after 9/11, anybody who said the words root causes was immediately branded a supporter of terrorism. That was unacceptable, because if you were trying to understand it, it must mean you support it. Instead of recognizing if you're serious about stopping it, making sure it never happens again, you damn well better understand it, because otherwise you're gonna fail. Well, they didn't, and they did. They didn't understand it, and they failed. They went to war and thought that was gonna work, and it doesn't work. The new escalations that are now underway between the new fights that are going on between Iran and Saudi Arabia, which have far more to do with traditional regional concerns about military control, oil control, money control, who's the dominant hegemon in the region, is it gonna be the Saudis or is it gonna be the Iranians? That has been going on for some years. It's escalating right now, and that makes everything else more dangerous. The air wars that are going on, the US air war, the Russian air war, they are devastating people. They are devastating cities. None of it is making anybody better. None of it is helping. It's all making it worse. Now, the reality of terrorism, as we're seeing it playing out in the Middle East now, and the rationale for the so-called global war on terror, right now is grounded very much in the war in Syria, which is not a civil war anymore. There was a civil war aspect to it, and there's that aspect remains. But this is now at least 8 separate wars that are global and regional as well as national. But they're all being fought to the last Syrian. So when Saudi Arabia goes to war against Iran in Syria, it's not Saudis and Iranians who are dying, it's Syrians. That's taking place across the region, concentrated in Syria. And the consequences of that are horrific, and you know some of them. The millions of people that have been forced to flee their homes, 4 million that have been forced to flee their country, the numbers of people that are being held under siege by all the various forces have besieged people, holding people who are now starving to death. I mean, luckily yesterday the UN got some food into 3 different towns. That's not enough. There's got to be an end to that war. And that means an end to that set of wars, because as I said, this is not just one war. That's why it's all so complicated to even imagine what the diplomacy might look like. The fact that there is diplomacy on the table, this is great, this is important, this is potentially worth something, but we cannot be anywhere close to complacent. One, that this whole process based on the Vienna talks is gonna go forward. 2, that it's gonna work. 3, that it will be maintained. We can't assume any of that. But we have to be looking not at how do we combine our military with other aspects of US power. We hear something from President Obama which is really important and right when he says there is no military solution. The problem is he acts as if there was, because every action that he does is a military action. And then he adds the part that isn't true. He says, well, the military part isn't enough. We also need diplomacy, we need negotiations, we need humanitarian assistance, we need this, we need that. The problem with that analysis is that it ignores the fact that it's not just about the military side isn't enough. The military side makes those other things, diplomacy, negotiations, humanitarian assistance, impossible. Imagine you're living in a Sunni community in Iraq, and you've started looking at ISIS a little differently because they at least claim that they're defending your rights against this incredibly brutal sectarian government that the UN put in, the US put in power and keeps in power and arms and backs in Baghdad. Right? So you're starting to look at ISIS as maybe being on your side. You don't like what they stand for, you don't like their extremism, but they are Sunnis that are defending Sunni rights. That's one of the reasons that ISIS has become so powerful, is that they don't fight alone. But so what happens? The US goes and they bomb a Sunni-based ISIS camp. And say they got it right, they almost never do, but imagine, let's give them credit for something they've never done. They manage a bombing that only gets ISIS militants. There's no civilian casualties. It's very narrow. They get the people they're going to. And what happens back here? Yay, we got the bad guys. And what do they see? What do people in the city see? Yeah, there's the Americans again, going to war for the Shia and the Kurds against the Sunnis. We better stick with ISIS. So it perpetuates exactly what the U.S. recognizes they need to do, which is to win people away from supporting ISIS. By going in militarily, it's creating an even greater problem. So that's the kind of failure we're looking at. Now, I don't have time. A lot of you are very familiar with some of the other failures, the more dramatic failures of these efforts to supposedly, we're gonna create and train a group of Syrian fighters who are going to be loyal to democracy and loyal to us all at the same time, and they're not going to fight against the regime, they're only going to fight against ISIS. Oh yeah, how'd that work for you? $500 million, and look what they got. They got nothing. They got buckus. So there's a lot of reasons that I'm not going to go into now because we don't have time, about the reasons for this war. A lot of them haven't changed since George Bush went to war, George Bush Sr. and George Bush Jr. Issues around oil, around power, around the expansion of U.S. military power. We go to war because the U.S. government tells us the choice is either war or nothing. It's what Bush said the day after 9/11. It was 9/12, the day the world changed, when Bush said, we either go to war or we let them get away with this. It was a lie then, it's a lie now. So when we look at sort of the origins of ISIS, again, you know, there's a long history here, but the U.S. occupation, the U.S. invasion of Iraq, the U.S. imprisonment of thousands of Iraqis, the torture of Iraqis, Guantanamo, all of the prisons where torture was going on a regular basis, that's what gave rise to ISIS. That's what we have to look at when we say, why are they fighting like this? That's the origins of it. That's the origins of it. It's not all that complicated. The military escalations that are underway now threaten the potential that we saw with the diplomacy that led to the Iran deal, that set the stage for the possibility, not the inevitability by any means, but the possibility of a new diplomacy-based rather than war-based policy in the region for a while. All of the new escalations, the U.S. escalation, the Russian escalation, all these escalations are making that much more dangerous, putting it at much greater risk. The question of what are the interests of each country are key. There's not a country participating in this war, in this so-called coalition. We don't need a coalition of the killing. That's what we've had in the past. We need a coalition of the rebuilding. But all of the interests of these governments is not in protecting their proxies, whether it's in Syria or in Iraq or anywhere else, in Afghanistan. It's to maintain their own power. That's true of the U.S., that's true of the Russians, it's true of the Iranians, it's true of the Saudis. Their human rights violations at home pale before what they're doing or allowing or encouraging their proxies to do in these wars. So this is what we need to be looking at. Now I have, and in the book is done as frequently asked questions, so one of the last questions is, so what should the policy be when a group like ISIS is so violent? Don't you need some kind of military? The problem is, how violent they are doesn't tell you what's going to work to destroy them, what's going to work to undermine their influence and their power. What we've seen is that going to war against them encourages their power. It makes it greater, not less. It's not working. We need to do something different. I outlined an 8 or 9 or 10 part policy of what the U.S. policy should look like. We can talk about that during the question period. But the final point I want to make, and this is also the last question in the book, is what do we do as people? What do we do as a movement? It's not enough to say, stop the bad stuff that we're doing that's making everything worse. We start, what should the policy be? Start with the Hippocratic Oath. First, do no harm. Stop killing more people. Stop the bombing. Stop the drones. Stop the attacks. You're killing more people, not less. So stop that. But then, it's not enough to say, pull out the troops, pull out the bombers. We have to talk about what is our obligation as citizens of the country that has become this empire that is fighting to dominate this region. We have a lot of work to do. And it means education, it means advocacy, it means mobilizing opposition. It's not easy. It's not easy. What we've seen is that people in large numbers are often not prepared to fight against U.S. wars unless there are U.S. casualties in large numbers. And the strategy of the Obama war is to avoid U.S. casualties at all costs. So when you make it into a drone war, you make it into a special ops war, you make it into an airstrike war, you're not having a lot of U.S. casualties. There's still a few happening in Afghanistan because there's still 10,000 troops on the ground. But in large numbers, no. And so people are not prepared at a moment of crisis, economic crisis, political crisis, and fear. When fear takes hold, and we're seeing this in these election run-ups right now more than anything else, at that moment, it's very hard to convince people that they should be worried about what US bombers are doing across the earth, where they're not killing Americans. That's our challenge. But it hasn't changed. The fact that ISIS is now one of the parties on the ground, you know, we heard a year and a half ago, we have to go after the regime in Syria because it's the worst thing that ever existed anywhere. It's a terrible regime. The US has relied on it for torture and for maintaining the Golan Heights, etc. But it's a terrible regime. But do we really think that militarily going after that regime is going to do better, like Iraq? But we have to get beyond the notion that we have no obligation to people that are struggling for freedom and liberation. We have huge obligations, but they don't include militarization and occupation. We have to be the creative ones to figure out, how do we reach other people? How do we do that education? How do we do that advocacy? How do we do the mobilization work, the protest work? How do we get people to engage and recognize that it is all of us? None of us are free until all of us are free. And that's an international reality. It's not just here. Thank you.
Is this, how's this microphone working? Okay, great. Well, I also want to, it's great to be here and to see so many folks here. And if this is crowded, that's probably good. It's fitting to be somewhat similar to what refugees face when there's not enough space. But hopefully we all plan to be here. But I want to thank Brooklyn for Peace and for Greenpeace also for inviting us here and really organizing the event and getting folks to be here. Because it's so important to kind of for us to figure out what is it we can do to make a difference here in this country. Just in this last year, I want to share, I've been to Lebanon twice, back in March and then again in October, visiting refugee camps and refugee communities there. I was in Jordan as well in the fall, and I've been to Palestine and Israel a number of times, and I go to Afghanistan regularly. So. I want to share a little bit to kind of complement what Phyllis put out there in terms of the stories of refugees and kind of what's happening in their lives. And I want to start with two proverbs, neither one from the Middle East, but one from Afghanistan, because I love Afghan proverbs, if folks are not familiar, are just terrific. So ask me about others if I forget. And then one from Africa as well. So the Afghan proverb is about Kabul, the capital, is in a basin at a very high altitude of like 6,500 feet, and is surrounded by mountains. And the saying is, more precious than gold is snow on the mountains of Kabul. And they shared that because it doesn't rain in Afghanistan. It snows in the winter, and in the spring, farmers can look up at the mountains and know, is there enough water in the snow melt for our crops to get to harvest? Or will our sons, and it's usually sons, need to go somewhere else to find work for our family to survive? That's without any of the politics, that's without any of the weapons that have flooded Afghanistan, that for centuries they understood in a drought-prone region, you need to move and adjust just to survive. And I think that if we look at the Middle East as well, where there is significant fragility in the ecosystem in terms of water resources, apart from any of the politics and the war, there are folks that are making those decisions as well. There's not enough water for our crops. And that was one of the things facing Syrian farmers, was about subsidies and how they could make a go of it. And so I just put that as a backdrop in terms of people being on the move. And then when you add a flood of weapons from outside, from a whole lot of sources, as Phyllis was mentioning, it's a recipe for disaster. And the second proverb is from Africa, I first heard it years ago, actually around the end of the Cold War, 1989, 1990. It was a Nigerian ambassador at the UN. And he said, you know, there's a Swahili proverb, an African proverb from different contexts. When two elephants fight, the grass gets trampled. He said, now suddenly, the Cold War is ending, and the two elephants are making love. And you know what? The grass is still being trampled. So just for right now, this next month or so, I'd like to add to that a kind of third, maybe this is a US North American version, that when elephants debate, the grass also gets trampled. So, you know, think about that proverb there. But that's a very serious aspect of how refugees have been politicized by government leaders, especially in this country, increasingly by some factions in Europe, and certainly in areas of the Middle East, with the politicization. So I want to touch on just kind of four aspects in the kind of dynamic of uprooted displaced persons. In some sense, refugees technically are those that have crossed an international border, but there's many folks who flee international, internally displaced persons. IDPs is another term that's used, but uprooted is also like folks flee. If there's not enough water for your crops, you will move. If there is fighting in your community, a lot of folks are just gonna say, I'm out of here. Not for, you know, hopefully for not long. And until recently, with the situation in Syria and Iraq and across the Middle East, Afghanistan was the largest refugee crisis. Palestine was the most long-standing refugee crisis. And I think that if we keep in mind what's happened with Afghan refugees who are still waiting to return, they're in Pakistan, they're in Iran, or they've returned and there's no land to return to. So they're in the cities with precarious jobs of what they can find. And Afghanistan now is more violent than ever in the last couple of years. And so this is over 30 some 40 years of displacement, when all that time weapons have been flooding in from the United States through the largest CIA covert operation, from the Soviet Union, from Saudi Arabia, from Pakistan, you name it, the list goes on. And that same dynamic, and I keep raising Afghanistan because in many ways the situation in Syria now is developing into this kind of dynamic of where a lot of groups are flooding it with weapons. And so we won't be able to address the situations of refugees. Is this still working here?
Yeah, if you can get a little closer, it would be
okay,
helpful.
Okay, I didn't have enough for dinner, so I'll try that. Is that better?
But you also have to raise your voice.
No, it was fine before.
Okay, I'll keep going.
You have a problem.
So in terms of refugees, I want to identify kind of four aspects of what is it that we can do. One is, first of all, the right to stay. Wouldn't it be great if folks didn't need to flee their communities in the first place? So what steps can be done to ensure that communities and individuals and families feel safe enough in their home communities to stay? And so that's one area. The second area is protection on the journey. So when folks have fled, they're often on the road. That's when they're most vulnerable to trafficking, to exploitation, sexual harassment for women refugees and for children. So there's incredible vulnerabilities there, but that's another element of protection in terms of where, how are their human rights upheld as they're kind of on the move. The third area is in terms of welcoming the communities where they arrive initially. And throughout history, most refugees and uprooted peoples have fled just enough to get out of the way. If there's an earthquake in California, folks generally move to New York. You know, they move a little ways away. So if you look at like Nepal, you know, natural disasters, but also with human crises of war and human rights violations, people move with the hope that they can return soon. So most of the refugees are in Turkey, in Lebanon, in Jordan. They fled across the border. There's actually a lot of back and forth. In a number of places, when things quiet down, folks will say, well, that's part of the family will go back. Maybe not all the family left. And so many families are divided right now with some in Syria, some in Lebanon, some having gone on to Europe, some in Canada or other places, some in Jordan. And so this division of families and communities is also a part of that. So that's the third, is what kind of welcome is there in the host communities, which are usually the countries right nearby, or the internally displaced that have moved from like one town to another in Iraq or Syria. And finally is the right return. Like, what enables people to be able to return? And what I saw in Lebanon was, which is the greatest proportion of crisis, it's a small country where close to one third of the population in the country now are refugees. So think about, like, if suddenly there was like another, over the next couple years, 4 million people in New York City with no change of the infrastructure. And that most of them are prohibited from any kind of meaningful work unless it's under the table. What would that do to the political, social infrastructure life here? And that's what's happening in Lebanon. You have a large number of Syrian refugees, but you also have Iraqi refugees that have fled from mostly from northern Iraq with the sort of rise of violence of ISIS kind of, and some of the changes that Phyllis talked about in the Sunni areas there. Then you also have Palestinians who, for refugees that were living in Syria, and now there's they fled, and then there are Palestinian refugees that have been in Lebanon since 1948. I visited some of those refugee camps, and there were refugees hosting other refugees. And yet there are political leaders in this country saying, well, I'm not sure if we can handle, you know, like, you know, 10,000 refugees. It's appalling. That is just really insulting to people's dignity to suggest that. And I think one of the things I want to just raise for us is that refugees give us the opportunity to say, are some lives more important than others? So this externalization of casualties and of consequences of military actions, that if there are no US casualties, there aren't casualties. It's low intensity conflict if we aren't some. And it's this us-them dynamic. And I think there's an opportunity for us to now say, you know, these are folks just like us. There's educated folks, there's farmers, there are bankers, there's jewelers, small business people, folks with disabilities who were like, how can I find care? I met some Syrian women who found it was more comfortable and worked better to be in a Palestinian refugee camp than in a refugee camp only for Syrians because they had a disabled child. And that was the place where they could get some services. So folks are scrambling to figure out, how do I just meet basic needs? And then how do I get on with my life when I still want to hold on to the fact that I want to return? And that was the most tragic aspect of these stories. And I think if we can lift those up, I want to say now just a couple things about some of the causes about that suddenly the world media discovered the refugee crisis this past summer when refugees started arriving in Europe. And so suddenly there was like, you know, there have been African refugees crossing the Mediterranean, also dying in a dangerous journey, and that wasn't getting the same kind of coverage. And so I just want to say, you know, like, let's use that opportunity. Let's be quite critical of why is it suddenly when they're coming to Europe. But what happened was there were folks that had been in Lebanon, had been in Turkey for 2, 3, 4 years now, couldn't find work, and were beginning to say, you know, we can't go home. There is no home to go back to. We need to get on with our lives in some way. What next? And so there was this opening of, we can't find work here. The donations to the World Food Program, to the UNHCR, the UN High Commission for Refugees, and the other programs that serve the refugee camps are coming in at about 35 to 40% funding. So if you don't have the money, they were reducing their food kits and their stipends that were available to refugees because they were like, we're going to run out. We've got too many refugees, and we can't meet their needs. Then it's like you hear this announcement from Germany of, well, we could take a certain number of refugees. If folks are feeling like that, it's like there's not enough snow. It's like being in this camp, there aren't jobs. There isn't a way to resettle here. And there aren't the resources to kind of keep waiting, and there's no place to go back home anymore. Then it makes sense that people would risk their children's lives, their own lives, to cross the Mediterranean to try and get to a place where they feel maybe there's some jobs. And I just wanted that human piece is really important for us, so that if we could help with the funding of the World Food Program and of various other organizations on the ground, then maybe the need for folks to flee would go down. It wouldn't solve the problem. I don't want to suggest that, like, you know, there's a difference between humanitarian assistance and trying to get at a genuine resolution. I want to say just a couple more things, and that is, I think, Phyllis, I want to come back to the militarization of problem solving. Political leaders have discovered that militarizing problem solving works for institutionalizing fear, and therefore stifling dissent. And its dictators and democracies are actually pretty good about this, that if you militarize the problem, then you have a monopoly on force as a government. And that could be the Assad regime, it could be the new regime in Iraq, it could have been Saddam Hussein before that, the US military and the US government, the various political leaders running for president right now. That's what we have to challenge, is to challenge the militarization that then refugees are just collateral damage instead of sisters and brothers. And it allows for this, if you institutionalize fear, you can blame the victims much more readily. And look at how refugees who are fleeing from a burning building, from a place that's been set on fire by all the weapons that have flooded Syria and Iraq over years, from the US military and from Saudis and from others. And then it's their fault that they got out of the way of this. And that's what I think we can begin to challenge. Finally, how else can we challenge it? Let's challenge the foreign terrorist organization list. If you want to be serious about diplomacy, you don't talk with your friends. You talk with the folks that have done some ugly stuff. And that's what negotiating is about. And it's hard for us. And I share this because there's a lot of different assessments of, like, you know, who's, whether it's just in Syria or in Iraq, who's ISIS, who are the others, what do we think about Assad regime. There are a lot of problems there. But I've also met communities, Christians, from Syria and Iraq, in many cases, not all cases, but in many cases, saw the Assad regime as a lesser of evils that created some space for them as communities compared to ISIS or compared to some of the other militant extremist groups. I'm not saying they like them, but if you still have relatives that are under government-controlled areas in Syria or ISIS-controlled areas, what do you do? How do you speak out on that? And I think it's a challenge for the people on the ground, but it's also a challenge for us to say, let's not demonize whole groups, but understand that in the tough work of trying to carve out ceasefires and to try and get lasting peace that, or at least a ceasefire enough that people can begin to return. So a couple, two last observations here. One is 2 years ago, remember with the chemical weapons with Syria, the world united for a moment. Russia and Syria and the US decided, hey, you know, we could actually come together because chemical weapons affects everybody. It wasn't an us and them with chemical weapons, it was like it affects everybody. That could affect us. So what could we do about it? When the weapons inspectors went into a community, there was a ceasefire. And all the groups realized that the game had changed. And at least for right now, when there were inspectors, we better all kind of quiet down. That meant there was some capacity for humanitarian assistance. Right now, we have what's called trickle-down relief. We have trickle-down economy, the economics of our supply-side economists and Republicans, but we also have trickle-down relief. Let's let in one convoy, and then CNN will go away. And the international community will be like, well, at least we got a little help to folks. But it doesn't solve the problem. It just solves a little bit of our guilt and conscience. And Gaza is an example of what happens when that happens over and over and over again. That you comp- completely seal off a community, and then every once in a while let a little bit in. And that's a chance for us to say, wait a minute, we need lasting ceasefires, and this will only work if we're talking to all the different groups and pushing them and cutting off the arms from outside. So I'll stop there, and I'll look forward to the questions and discussion.
Before I introduce David Tarkolsker, who will pull at your heartstrings, just a few more thank yous. I want to recognize the Peace and Economic Justice Committee of Brooklyn for Peace that has worked incredibly hard to bring this evening together, and really much appreciation to all the folks who worked to do this. And my other just quick thought, as I was listening to Phyllis and David, I teach at a university, and sometimes we get these advertisements for speakers who are talking on public subjects, and their fees are $10,000 to come to a college campus for, no, you can't, no one wants to. We get these lists, we can have these phenomenal guests, and then our university sometimes gets really sneaky and actually, gives money to those people. Among them, many years ago, was Chalabi, who we honored with. So, I was just listening to David and Phyllis, and I was thinking how easily we take our own speakers for granted here. And I really just want to emphasize that Phyllis and David have been all over speaking, writing, doing as much possible work as anybody could do without a lot of reward. And I just think it's really important to recognize the tremendous contribution. David, are you somewhere?
I'm here.
Okay, David Katkowski.
Hi there, I am the Vice Chair of Brooklyn for Peace. This is where I say to you, this event costs money. But actually, I want to ask you to notice the times that we're in. A time of fear, a time in which I think by any objective measure, things have gone backwards. And it is important and vital that we have an organization that is committed to organizing in Brooklyn, that is willing to take on difficult issues of war and peace, unpopular issues of war and peace, and we need you to dig deep.
Dig deep.
Right? There's a big hit musical on Broadway. Unless you put the picture of Mr. Hamilton or somebody like that in there, you're not going to get a ticket, let me be very clear. Okay, the other thing, many of you are aware that one of the truly appalling aspects of recent events has been the attacks on the hospitals of Doctors Without Borders, including by the United States in Kunduz, by Saudi Arabia in Yemen, and apparently by the Syrian government in Syria. We're going to donate half of tonight's proceeds from this collection to Doctors Without Borders to do work in Syria. It is vital in the face of a medical system due to this atrocious civil war that we find some way of expressing our human solidarity with the Syrians. And we ask you to really give a little extra, because certainly it's going to a really important cause. Thank you very much.
All right, are we ready for a Q&A? Let me encourage everybody. Obviously, many important things have been raised tonight. People have a lot of thoughts and questions, so I would encourage people to be brief. And let's see if we can work it that people could stand up and speak from where you're now sitting, and hope that that will work. Okay, so let me go right here in the front and identify yourself.
Yeah, my name is Keith. I agree with what Phyllis was saying, that the key question is, what do we do? And I think this is one of the most complicated political situations that I can remember in terms of my political awareness, in terms of all the different forces at play. but I think it's really important to expand the context even further, which is that in 1998, the fall of the Soviet Union, the collapse of the Soviet Union, it's now a unipolar world, there's a document called Project for a New American Century that talks about maintaining U.S. domination around the world and stopping any threats to it.
I think
it's important to expand the context, which is that the what's going on in the Middle East is, in the words of Condoleezza Rice, time to redo the Middle East. And it's not just this situation and that situation. This is the machinations of the United States, along with other forces. I think Russia coming into the situation forced Obama's hand. And the question I have is, what do we do when you have all these different forces at work in that larger context?
Okay.
Well, it's obviously a very big question, but I would say that the brief thing is, what we can do in this country is mainly about what our country is doing, what our government is doing. So there is agency for people in the region, decreasing agency, I would say, as governments crack down, as outside forces flood the area with weapons. It takes away the agency of people who live there, but there is still agency for people who live in that part of the world. Our main responsibility, I would assert, is to change what our government does. It's the same thing in our work around Palestine. For me, Palestinian rights can best be fought for by challenging U.S. enabling of Israeli violations of Palestinian rights. So I don't have a whole lot of influence on Israel. I don't have a whole lot of influence on U.S. government either, but I have some. I have some. Our government still is a government. It's not. We haven't lost all ability to influence it. So I think that's what our job has to be. But the problem that we... The problem that we face, one very big problem that we face, and that's why I said education and advocacy and protest all have to be part of our work. The education part is that people are being educated intensely, powerfully, and successfully to believe a lie. The lie is that individual terrorism is the most important threat to all of us and to our nation. That we somehow face an existential threat. It's the same thing Israelis are being taught, and it's working. So I think that our first job is to do the counter-education. And it means we have to learn some stuff. We don't have to be experts on ISIS. We don't have to know every detail of the theological differences between Sunni and Shia. We don't have to know all that. We do have to know that you can't bomb terrorism out of existence. Those are the kinds of things we need to know. And then we need to teach. We need to reach other people with them. That's the beginning of our job. And it's going to be harder than perhaps ever in the lives of our memories.
I'm going to go right here and then the back.
My name is Roberto. Questions. Do you think that the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is part of the reason for the blowback? And secondly, what do you think the reaction would be if there was somehow a just resolution to the conflict would occur? How do you think the Muslim world would react to that?
Phyllis, you want to just restate the
question? Was whether the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is part of the reason for the crisis that's going on, and if there were to be a just solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, how would the rest of the surrounding region likely respond? I think David will answer too. My own sense is there's no question that U.S. support for Israeli occupation and Israeli apartheid is part of the level of anger at the U.S. and the West, if you will, that's gone on for generations in the region. And it certainly is part of the reason for anger and opposition now. I don't think there's any question about that. When we saw the mobilizations across the region in what was known as the Arab Spring, although the immediate demands were political rights and jobs and dignity, you didn't have to scratch the surface very much to find the question of outrage at how Palestinians had been treated for generations to find part of the motivation there as well. So I think there's no question that that is a component of what's going on. It's not probably right now the main component in popular consciousness in the region, but it is absolutely part of how people see it. Okay, you should.
Yeah, I'll add a couple of points on that. I think one is that for many years, repressive Arab regimes across the Middle East could use lip service for concern about Palestinians to ignore or sustain even the repression internally. So it was a way of letting off steam of the Arab street. And we don't have enough time to go into that, but that has been misused when in fact they did nothing beyond lip service to actually really push for a genuine just peace for Palestinians in Israel. So that's one thing. The second thing is, I think there's an element of the US for a long time has wanted controlled and institutionalized instability in the Middle East. Because if you have weak governments in relation to all that oil, they need somebody to protect them. And no one else can guarantee the continuation of many of those regimes than the US military. By the way, if we have a base in Bahrain, that would be really nice. And if we had a couple other bases maybe in Saudi Arabia, oops, that kind of caused a problem. So that's the second thing. The third thing I would say is that you have this massive arms industry, and Israel now is one of the largest producer of arms as well. You gotta have customers. You can't have customers if everybody's getting along with each other. So you need insecurity and fear elsewhere as well. And if you look at most of the US is still the largest, over half of all arms sales and transfers in the world today for the last couple of years have been from the United States. That is big business. Russia has seen the same business. So flooding Syria right now, flooding Yemen and Iraq with weapons from outside is good business for somebody. And so that's a place to challenge. Then the last thing, I won't speak about how the Muslim world perceives this, but in 2002, the Bush administration issued a required paper, the National Security Strategy paper. And in that paper they said, this is not a clash of civilizations that we're facing right now in the global war on terror, but a clash within the heart of Islam. And this is a battle that we, as the US government, must excel in. So this is a kind of, we, the US government, benefits from the Muslim world being seen as divided, Sunni-Shia differences. It's not that there aren't differences, but if you can militarize those differences, then the powerful military-industrial complex benefits.
I think I see a hand back there.
Yeah, my name is Andy. I'm with the Middle East North Africa Solidarity Network. Before I make my main point,
Andy, do you want to stand up?
Sure, it's a little hard with the table here. Before I make my main point, if I have my denomination straight, I think we owe David a congratulatory round of applause. I believe it's your United Methodist Church, which just passed the great divestment resolution targeting five Israeli banks. So thank you for all your hard work on that. My main point is I wanted to extrapolate from the comment or the quote from the Christian refugees who saw Assad as a lesser evil. If your framework is to try to solve this problem with negotiations between governments internal to the region or external, it's a very understandable sentiment they're under the gun. However, I think our framework should be the very last thing that Phyllis said in terms of supporting people who've been struggling for, and I forget which adjective she used, justice and liberation and dignity, et cetera. There are people in Syria without arms who every day are confronting the Assad regime and Daesh and Nusra and all the other reactionaries. For time's sake, I won't go into details, examples, but I would encourage everyone, and I'll end on this, follow a website called SyriaFreedomForever.wordpress.com. Again, that's SyriaFreedomForever.wordpress.com, and you'll see hundreds and hundreds of examples of the continuing revolution, the grassroots revolution in Syria.
Nonviolent movements. There have been folks pushing for human rights. I mean, we forget now that in the Iranian Revolution in 1979, it was not only the Ayatollah. There was Iranian workers and the trade union movement. There were left parties that had been under repression under the Shah, but there was a lot of folks who were glad to see one regime leave, but there was a struggle. And so I think how we can lift up those forces in every context is always important for us to keep that in mind, and that human rights are not something that we trade and barter about, but are things to be protected and lifted up and supported for everybody.
Just one short thing, just on that comment. I think that it's also one thing that we can do is whenever there is discussion about the diplomatic side, which begins with the outside forces and then begin and then moves to the inside forces, to demand over and over and over again the participation of civil society, of women's organizations, of the nonviolent mobilizations that have been functioning under incredible pressures in Syria over the last 5 years, that all of them must be at the table. The refugees need to be represented, including the Palestinian refugees from inside Syria, who have now been made refugees for the fifth time, some of them. So all of those factors have to come into what how we demand what real diplomacy has to look like.
Questions on this side, okay. Too, please?
I'll get to you. I'm right. Moving in that direction.
Okay.
All right.
You're always looking on there.
Well,
to your left, as we say. Yeah.
You know, when people are in darkness, just be patient. I'll get to you next. Go ahead.
Bruce, one thing that's happened in the last year, it doesn't seem to have changed things, but I wonder why, is the collapse of the oil market, which looks like it's going to be that way for a period of time. Now, how does that affect the situation, and how does that affect what you think we would do, or doesn't?
Yeah, it's a very good question, and it certainly does. I would say, by the book, there's a whole section on the oil industry where that fits in. I think that what we're seeing right now is more evidence, if anybody needed any, of the Saudi commitment to maintaining their market share in a period when they are prepared to accept huge losses because of the diminished price of oil. And the significance of that is they're not the only oil producer around. They're not the only oil producer in that region. But they are the only one of the major oil producers in that region that have enough investment in non-oil income, meaning hotels in New York and real estate in London and factories in China, you know, all over the world, that they can afford to let it slide, to let the price go down, and not sell off, not tighten the production, which would then raise the prices, in order to keep their own share of the oil market. So it's a very complicated question. What we're seeing in the immediate link is that ISIS in particular, excuse me, but some of the other organizations as well, are gaining from the oil industry. Because if you look at ISIS, although they are losing some level of territory now, it's part of the reason that they're turning more towards old-fashioned international terrorism against soft targets, is because they're losing, they probably lost about 25% of the territory that they held in both Iraq and Syria. But in that context, the territory that they held and still hold includes, in Syria in particular, most of the oil production areas. Syria is not a major oil producer on the global scale, but it produces some. It's not insignificant. And in the context of ISIS, the oil production has been one of the major ways that it's stayed in power, one of the major ways that it's getting money. It's not the only way. They have a host of other support, including from Saudi Arabia. But also through kidnapping, through fees, through taxes, through the sales of stolen artifacts, a whole range of things. But the oil production is a huge part of that. So it plays this major role in looking at what are people fighting to hold on to. ISIS is fighting to hold on to territory that has oil in it. It also goes to the question of who is ISIS trying to attract. So some they're trying to attract pathological killers who will carry out these kinds of horrific personal one-on-one kinds of violence that we've seen on those horrific videos and such. But they also need oil engineers. They need accountants who know how to deal with the global oil industry. You know, they need doctors. They need teachers. They're operating off a kind of 7th century ideology. But they are operating off a very 21st century state that they're building with the need for 21st century oil connections. So the role of oil in that region, even putting aside the fundamental role of oil as the region, as the reason that all these outside powers are involved there in the first place. We all know the famous statement during Bush 1's administration that if Iraq produced broccoli, nobody would be bothering when they invaded Kuwait. I'm talking very much. But, you know, that part is true as sort of the overview. But there's these immediate things in terms of the Saudis, in terms of ISIS, all the various players. If you look at the Kurds right now, the Kurds have emerged quite quietly in terms of seizing the moment when they have emerged as military heroes in parts of both Iraq and Syria. The US sees them as their key military allies in both Syria and Iraq. They don't talk about it too much because they don't want to insult their NATO allies in Turkey. But in this whole period, suddenly the town of Kirkuk, in a major oil-producing center in Iraq, which was always kind of being battled back and forth, would it be under the control of the Iraqi Kurdish region, or would it be part of the rest of Iraq, of Arab Iraq? And it was in the Arab side. But suddenly, if you look at maps now, it suddenly is part of Iraqi Kurdistan. Nobody sort of noticed that. It just kind of happened while all this was going on. And the reason that the Kurds were so intent on getting control of Kirkuk is because of oil, because it's a major oil production region. So all of this is going on with oil right at the center of it.
Three quick points to add to that, and thank you for raising that. I think it's, you know, watching what the oil is doing. There's a long documented history of oil-producing states and repressive regimes, because you get a lot of money. Once the wells are drilled, you get a lot of money with very few workers, so that it's concentrated in one place. So if you look at, you know, Nigeria as an example in Africa, but across the Gulf states, then you can use a large amount of migrant labor. So across the Middle East, you have a huge workforce in the service sector that's doing things that have no rights as migrants. And so that's, second thing is that I think that this has shown that the strategy of OPEC that was working quite effectively for quite a few decades is not working anymore, and that the Saudis are trying to figure out a way to strategize to glut the market. So it's a kind of Walmart strategy of you underprice your competitors. So Russia's economy depends on oil, Iran, Iraq, and you kind of devastate their economies, which puts some pressure on them as well, and you can withstand the pressure longer. And finally, you know, that it's the largest trade commodity. So there's still big, big money, even if the prices are really cheap. So I'd say watch that, but it's going to stay low, and it's going to keep creating some tensions of folks doing some other more stupid, violent, destructive things.
The one thing it does mean, though, is that fracking becomes less profitable because it's no longer
good for the environment.
Okay, so for those who are concerned that there's discrimination on the left,
I think you're left.
And then, okay. Maddie, do you have a question, Maddie?
Yeah, well, let me ask my question.
Okay.
My question is, since there is...
Name?
My name is Tom Weiss. I publish up front news. I've been here a lot. And I'm somewhat involved with the Bernie Sanders campaign. And now there is absolute possibility that he could become the president. So my question to you would be, if you were, I'll work it out, become an advisor to President Sanders, why Hillary's cooling her heels someplace, maybe in Iraq. But in terms of two things. One, with regard to the obviously changing military threat that ISIS represents, because they've lost some territory. They're going to go for some more. Hitler was always after the oil, and when he lost North Africa, that changed things. What would be your recommendation, assuming that ISIS still exists on January 20th, the day of the inauguration, what would be your recommendation in terms of how to respond to the military threat? And secondly, I used to work for a refugee organization, so I'm sensitive to that. Refugee resettlement organization, how would you address the question, since the refugee crisis is not going to recede unless Jesus comes back or something like that, he's not coming back yet. So what would be your recommendations as a presidential advisor in terms of an actual policy, or maybe, you know, legislation in terms of planning money for the military? That would be my question.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Both of you, since you're both going to be his advisors.
Weigh this carefully, because who knows where you'll be a year.
Really? Well, let me just make a disclaimer first. I work for a church, and the United Methodist Church, and contrary to many evangelical churches in Iowa, I don't endorse candidates. That
not
would be a violation.
No,
no, no. And so let me just say, I will address the policies for whoever happens to be in the White House. The first thing I think is we have to say, like, what military threat? And to distinguish between the rhetoric, because there's a lot of stuff out there of fear-mongering that is not really a military threat. The second thing on that I would say is gasoline is really a lousy strategy for putting out a fire. And so more arms into the regions of conflict is like pouring gasoline on a fire. Now when you put a backfire out, because you know you're fighting a forest fire, you do that if the wind is blowing a certain direction. But if it's blowing the other direction, starting that extra fire is a disaster. And so what I would say is we have to sort out, and more to that, but that's just a start on that. On the refugee question, I think it's to see folks not as refugees, but to see folks as sisters and brothers, as people like ourselves, who have been uprooted, and therefore have this technical classification as a refugee, which allows and affords special rights only if the world community stands by them in that moment, and that we haven't solved the Palestinian refugee crisis yet. And the reality is just having folks go away is one, you know, like the tradition in this country in relation to Native American communities is that 99% of Native Americans that lived here, the population has been destroyed and decimated from 500 years ago. That's a strategy, that's an awful strategy. And so I think standing with and solidarity with refugees is always important. And distinguishing between, when we talk about we have sort of diplomatic solutions, is talking to folks is not the same as affording all sides equal treatment. So you, and I want to make clear that you need to talk with so-called bad guys, you need to talk with everybody, because everyone needs to be a part of the solution. And it's often human rights violators you need to talk with. And that's hard. And so on behalf of the refugees, what can we do to press everybody to get around the table?
I would just add on the question of how we see military solutions is to acknowledge that we've been at war with terrorism for 15 years and it hasn't worked. There's a lesson there, which is that it doesn't work. So doing it better isn't the answer. Doing something different is the answer. So the difference is we have a set of things diplomatically, a set of things in terms of humanitarian support. But none of them are possible as long as the military stuff is being answered with greater military. So if we look, for example, at what happened, if we look at what we used to call the CNN factor, and now we might call it the Twitter factor, it was because of public pressure in the United States that the Obama administration, which had been very resistant to further escalation beyond where they already were, in 2013 when the crisis happened in Mount Sinjar. And the US sent bombers and sent airstrikes. And what happened was the people that were encircled by ISIS, it was a military threat to a community, they weren't saved by those airstrikes. They were saved by Syrian Kurds who rescued them and opened a corridor through the ISIS lines, escorted them off the mountain, along the border, and then back in so they could come back to safety. What the U.S. did was they dropped two or three bombs in that area, and then they took their bombers up to the area around Erbil in northern Iraq, which is what they were really worried about because there's oil there. And they wanted to make sure that ISIS didn't get anywhere near the oil fields. So we have to be cynical enough to recognize that the response of our government, again, it comes back to our obligation in this country as people who live and pay taxes in this country. Some are citizens, some are not. We all live here, we all have obligations to this government, is to recognize that those military actions that are taken, sometimes even in response to public demand, don't work. So we have to say sometimes, okay, there's not going to be an instant answer to this particular crisis, because when we send the military to do it, there isn't any way. We can't allow this politically driven militarization of problems, as David described it, to continue. it doesn't work and it makes things worse. So the kinds of diplomacy that we need to start talking about an arms embargo. You know, we hear from the U.S., we hear one side all the time. We need to get Russia and Iran to stop arming the Assad regime. Well, I agree with that, but do we really think the U.S. is going to have any influence on Russia and Iran as long as they're flooding the region with their own weapons on every other side? No. So we need to be talking about an arms embargo on all sides. That's not an easy discussion to have, partly because of the power of the military producers, partly because of the politics of it. You're saying you want to abandon people there? It's because those military uses, the military weapons, don't work. It comes back to what works against terrorism. The only thing that works is going after the root causes that create terrorism. That's what has to change. And as long as your starting point is the military, it's not going to work.
Matt, did I see a question
here? Oh. I'm not very fast. Nobody can understand me. Actually, I have a little story to relate to you because I'm Matt Weinstein from the Peace and Economic Justice Committee that Rusty mentioned. We organized, in over a short period of a few weeks, on some Brooklyn street corners, this was before and after the Paris attacks, petition tables. And I want to tell you, because everybody is so doom and gloom, and recent polls have shown now that the American people have been pushed into supporting the military adventure against ISIS because of the great mass media, and you know, but that before and even after the attacks in Paris, the sentiments on the street corners of our neighborhoods in Brooklyn has been overwhelmingly anti-war, anti-getting involved in another military adventure and another endless war, and also very pro accepting and welcoming refugees from various places. So there are good folks out there, and never doubt that a small bunch of people like yourselves and ourselves can go out and reach people. Second part of the story, six Democrats inhabit the House delegation from Brooklyn. It used to be 5-1 Republican, but he wanted to push a reporter off of what was his name?
Grim.
He's in jail. So, six of them. He took the 600 signatures collected over 2 or 3 weekends and sent them to each one of those Democratic reps in the House. Why did we do that? Because just a month or so earlier, Brooklyn for Peace was very instrumental in organizing petitions, phone calls, letters, protests outside the offices of these various reps. I stood in front of Yvette Clark's office, and she didn't make a commitment, it was right before, but you know, we have a very large Jewish community in Brooklyn. Clark, Nadler, Velasquez all have very conservative parts of their district, more Orthodox, more religious people that did not want that agreement with Iran to go through. Each and every one of them supported it, Nadler first, and each and every one of them has been ganged up by the likes of Dove Heiken from Borough Park, reactionary people pushing back on them. So it's important for us not only to congratulate them on taking a stand on what was before unthinkable, that they would not vote with AIPAC, and vote against Obama and his push for diplomacy. There's a lesson to be learned there. And the lesson is right now that on this question of pushing for diplomacy, they are going to be under pressure for a no-fly zone, for example, which is what Clinton proposes, which, by the way, sounds very innocuous, but involves tens of thousands of U.S. troops on the ground in order to enforce it, according to the Joint Chiefs of Staff. I didn't say that. So right now, it's up to us to put pressure on this House delegation to say we don't want another war. We want to welcome refugees, which is the great American humanitarian tradition of opening our hearts and our homes to people who are under attack. And we don't want another war, and we don't want another $1 trillion spent on a new regional war that could explode into a world war. So these are things, and if you haven't signed that petition yet, this is the time to do it. If you would you address a shining example of why a military solution does not exist? The horrific article on the front page of the New York Times just several days ago about what the U.S. bombing and teaming up with Iraqi security army did to the city of Ramadi, a 400,000 population city, does not exist anymore. If that's a victory against ISIS, what's going to happen when they go after Raqqa and all the Syrian cities and more Iraqi cities? This is like a holocaust that's been unleashed. And if that doesn't feed the ranks of terrorism, as you implied, I don't know what else would. That's some victory against ISIS, where they demolished the city. The New York Times reporter asked their Syrian military envoy, where will the people, how will the people return to their homes as he was driven through this dust of the city that remains? And he said, what homes? There are no homes to go to. 400,000 people cannot return to Ramadi. Do you have any more facts about what they did there?
Yeah, it was one of the things I was going to talk about, actually, and we didn't have enough time, but the Ramadi is a classic example of a Pyrrhic victory. It was heralded as this great victory over ISIS, and that the flag of Iraq now flies over Ramadi instead of the ISIS flag. Well, you know, I guess that's a good thing, but for people who live there, it's the old Vietnam statement, we had to destroy the village in order to save it. It's a Pyrrhic victory. It's not a victory at all. That's why there is no military solution. It makes things worse. And I think, you know, the cost, I would just add one point to Matt's very important statement just now. I agree with every word of it. When we hear about how no one wants war, nobody wants war. Yes, they do. The people who make a profit off of war, they want war. And just so you know, yeah, they don't necessarily want it in their own backyard, but they want war to continue so they can make the profit in their own backyard. And for those of you wondering, the cost of just the so-called U.S. war against ISIS from 2014, from August of 2014 until now, just New York City, you have all now paid $247 million of your tax money just for that period, just New York City. And if you had that money back here to deal with within the city, you could have paid for 2,420 Head Start slots for poor children in this neighborhood. 1,913 veterans could get health care. Or 9,152 university students could get four-year scholarships. You do the math. What makes us safer? What makes people in Iraq safer? The destruction of Ramadi or diplomacy rather than war?
You know, if I could just come in for a second on Ramadi, because it keeps driving me crazy. And it relates to this thing about what doesn't work. Before ISIS, were U.S. military in Ramadi, put there by General Petraeus, who had his theory about how you would stop all the problems in Iraq. And when I was teaching my class at university, I had in my class a fellow who was an officer, and had just come back. He was a vet, and he had been in Ramadi. And you know, almost anything we would talk about, he'd say, Professor, Ramadi is great. You have to understand, they love us in Ramadi. It's cool, Professor. No, this shows that if you put the American military on the ground, we can establish those relationships, we can build a better world. I can tell you that the people in Ramadi thank General Petraeus and thank us. And I keep, every time when I think of what happened in Ramadi, I think of, oh, well, that was 2008, where everything was fine. But it's a very serious point. I mean, that there is this sense that you can get an illusion, right, that you're accomplishing something. There are these moments where it looks that way. That's what it looked like in Afghanistan, right, in 2002. We, you know, things were really better, but I think that there's a kind of a delusion that goes on, and we're still caught in it.
So I have three things I'd like to just say on that quickly. One is, in terms of members of Congress, like, that's our own diplomatic efforts, which is what I call congratulate and confront. So can we really thank folks when they've done something right, like on the Iran deal? And I think, you know, looking back, Obama, from when he was a candidate, said war with Iran would be an absolutely disastrous thing. What we have if we don't, short of war, is a lot of questions. But he pushed for a diplomatic effort. So can we thank him on that and then confront him on a laundry list of other things that are not going so well? The same with the members of Congress. But they want war on the cheap. Congress could pass an authorization to war, and Obama would sign it right now to be in keeping with the Constitution. But there is a war, but a war without that mandate and without that legal framework, it allows them to have this rhetoric of carpet bombing, allows no accountability. The second thing I want to say is, Let's give a shout out to Angela Merkel. She's one of my conservative sisters that I generally don't celebrate, but she has used the history of Germany as a nation and as a people that created way too many refugees in its recent history to say, you know what, how dare we not accept refugees and learn from the sins and the wrongdoings of our past. What if the US government took a lesson from that and said, you know, I mean, that was it helps with jobs. I mean, there's a win-win thing in there of welcoming refugees. And the third thing I want to say is that for welcoming refugees, the governors, the mayor of New York, Governor of Connecticut, who said, look, if Texas won't take folks, and if Georgia won't take folks, it won't follow the law, will take them. It's to shame the politics of fear. It's not really a solution to what's happening in the Middle East or in Afghanistan or elsewhere to bring all the refugees or even large numbers of refugees to the United States. But welcoming refugees is a way of shaming and challenging and rejecting the politics of fear.
Let me just add one point on the refugees too, because I think this is really fundamental in how we talk about the wars as well. It's not a separate issue. There was a very important statement a couple of months ago by the foreign policy chief of the European Union who said, look, let's everybody calm down. She said, there is a refugee crisis. In Turkey, there are 2.4 million Syrian refugees. In Lebanon, she used the example that David mentioned earlier, that one out of every three or four people in the country is now a Syrian refugee. She said, that's a crisis. Here in Europe, we don't have a crisis. We have a problem we need to resolve, and we can resolve it. We have the capacity for that. In the United States, there is no refugee crisis. There is a racism crisis. That's what we're facing. There is a racism crisis. And that's how we have to treat it. So this is, I think, a crucial component of how war and racism intersect. They build up the fear of people coming here. Where, who will they be? Will they be sneaking in to commit bad acts? These desperate people who are fleeing our weapons far too often? Or will we welcome people who are fleeing for those who need to come, a tiny percentage of those who have been forced to flee in the first place? But that's how they then justify, that's why we have to use the military over there to stop them from coming here. It was talked about that overtly in the early days around both Afghanistan and Iraq, where we heard, we've got to stop them there so they don't come here. Well, trust me, they don't want to come here if they can go home. This is not anybody's first choice.
Let me add, there's a delightful but disturbing Afghan proverb that I think, if none of the rest of this works, maybe this will help, which is, thrust your sword deeper into my belly so my small dagger can reach you. Now, but listen to that. Of what ISIS is saying is, come on, bomb more, get boots on the ground. You can do it, because our daggers will get to you. And you know what? We're not going away. And there's something of that macho challenge that I mentioned.
That's a response.
And so, if all else fails, just say ISIS wants us to be there. What do we think about that? Are you a fan and an ally of ISIS if you're advocating these military responses?
Al Qaeda wanted it too. Look where it happens.
Someone back there.
Okay, exactly.
Women that wanted to ask questions over here.
Okay. I'm
going to
go to that corner and then I'll swing back over here, okay?
Right.
Yes, go ahead.
Excuse me, at a global power level, in particular, I'm referring to the United States, do you think there's influence, there was influence upon the Saudis to open the spigots on their oil wells to flood the market in order to adversely affect the power of Russia and to crush Russia? I find it hard to believe that that the Saudis on their own took those dramatic steps to change the economic power structure of the world based upon oil without influence of the United States. And if that has the desired effect to break the back of the Russian bear, and if Russia was removed from the conflict to a certain degree due to protect their own self-interest, then how would that affect the overall picture? picture that we have now of global terrorism?
You know, you raise several different intersecting questions there. I think that the Saudi-U.S. relationship is very close on oil strategy issues. I don't think in this case it was the U.S. initiating it. I think it was the Saudis, because what's going on in Saudi Arabia, and this comes back to this whole question of how do we look at regional and national agency. Governments, unfortunately, some of the worst governments around, have a lot more agency than they should. And right now, what's happening in Saudi Arabia is a huge generational shift that's underway. So you have a king who is essentially, there's too much dementia, he's barely functional. And his chosen deputy crown prince, his son, who's only not even 30 years old, is trying to make a name for himself, particularly domestically, but also internationally, as the one who's going to change Saudi policy, both in the region and globally, so that he will be the inevitable choice when the royal family and the princes get together to figure out who's going to follow the next official crown prince who's the same age as the king. So, which means he won't last more than a couple of years. This is the guy who wants to be king for the next 40 years. And he's making clear on it now. He's the one calling the shots on oil policy and particularly on military policy. So there's a huge shift underway. For those of you who have followed the politics in the region, you know that traditionally the Saudis play a very quiet, understated role. They don't function in a very public way. Their diplomacy is under the table. They've turned down the chance, for example, to serve on the UN Security Council because they don't want to be in the public eye. They do things, they're obviously a very powerful actor, but they do it through money. They send their money around the world to build pro-Saudi institutions, schools, madrasas, mosques, other things. They send Saudi-trained preachers around the world to preach their version of Islam, their version of Wahhabism. So all of that has been going on. Now, what you have is a new generation of the royal family asserting themselves, saying, no, we're not going to do this backdoor stuff anymore. We're going to be right out there in front. So they're going to war in Yemen. They're escalating the war in Yemen. They're reopening battles with the Iranians deliberately, the most provocative acts they can do, deliberately designed to shore up the divide in the Arab world, because this is all part of their effort to become the hegemonic power and to defeat Iran's effort to be the hegemonic power. I think it's a mistake to see that as solely the U.S. pushing them to do that, because the U.S. has some real questions about whether the Saudis are the most reliable ally, and that's what a lot of the debate around the Iran deal was all about. Is there room for a new grand bargain with Iran? Is there room for the U.S. to have a different kind of relationship with Iran, which would be to the detriment of the Saudis, and that's a lot what the Saudis are responding to. So this is a lot internal Saudi politics playing out as much as anything else.
All right, so to my right, I don't want people on the right to feel discriminated.
There's nobody over there. And someone over there. Women wanted to ask questions.
Women.
Yes, go.
Over there.
I'm actually not seeing who it is.
Okay.
Yes, go ahead. Sorry.
Sorry.
The lighting here is actually, I apologize in advance to everybody, because the lighting is terrible. So if you're getting ignored, it's not personal. Okay, go ahead.
No, it's fine. My name is Kate. I work with Peace Action New York State. And my question is about the peace process for Syria. Phyllis, you had mentioned that there's a broad swath of civil society organizations that need to be consulted in diplomacy and in establishing any kind of sustainable peace in the region. So I'm wondering, what are those civil society organizations asking for in the peace process? And what would a peace deal look like that wasn't just an end to open hostilities, but actually began to repair the damage of the conflict and get to some of those core causes, underlying causes of terrorism in the region?
Yeah, it's a very important question. One of the big problems is there's huge disparities between what people and organizations believe. There are organizations who remain committed to political mobilization against the regime and nonviolent actions and are incredibly brave in still being out in the streets protesting the repression of the regime. There are others whose main focus is on ending the war, just stopping the level of violence that's underway now, who are trying to get the UN to negotiate these local ceasefires with the expectation that they will be able to be expanded to citywide and then later regional and eventually a national ceasefire can take hold. One of the big problems is there's a wide variety. When you talk about civil society in Syria, you're talking about a huge range of political ideas. There are women's organizations who are determined to have women's voices at the table. There are reactionary forces that are part of civil society in Syria that are dead set against that. So there is no single civil society position, just as there is no single position of the Syrian opposition, who are allied with a variety of forces outside, who have a variety of views on whether or not they want to use weapons to fight, whether they want the US to set up a no-fly zone. There are pacifists in Syria who want a no-fly zone if somebody else sets it up. There are plenty of pacifists who say, no, we don't, because that means war. So there are huge disparities. There's no one point that you can say somehow represents all of Syrian society. I think that's part of the reason why there's some hope for the process that's underway, even though it's going in this, what looks like a really ass backwards, frankly, pardon my language, approach of starting with the outside actors. Because frankly, if the outside actors would declare among themselves a ceasefire of any sort and an arms embargo of any sort, that would give some space to the internal actors, and it would put pressure on those that are armed to stop. So it's that process that's underway, and it's going to be a really difficult one to pull off.
Did you want to add something?
Yeah, I'll add just a couple things. I think it's always important to lift up the humanitarian band-aid so that it's not, we don't wait for a negotiation to say that people have a right to food, have a right to protection right now. And so I think that like this opportunity now about opening some safe corridors, saying those corridors should be permanent in terms of access. And you guys with weapons can't sort it out, but you should not take it out on the public. The non-combatant civilian population. And you know, you ask it, it doesn't work, it fails, until folks suddenly somehow get consensus. So briefly, around the chemical weapons, that happened. It wasn't sustainable, but there was a moment with chemical weapons, there was enough pressure from outside that all of the parties with weapons momentarily abided with those ceasefires. And so that's why I think, you know, never forget the humanitarian mandate, but recognize that that's not the solution, but it's a necessary component always to lift up for the people. And the second thing is, gasoline, I said earlier, just is really lousy for putting out a fire. So the fire may still be going on, it will still be going on, but you won't be making it worse. And I think that's very hard for political leaders. If the US put even a tenth of the money that we've put into the military wars in the region into humanitarian mandate, it would all be fully funded. And that is not getting to diplomacy, but if you can sustain the communities, then people have more of a vested interest to say the weapons is not the way to go. But right now, if you're a group that gets a few weapons, and it's like, well, you know, I'll do better if I just sell these to the other guys, you know, that fuels the cycle.
Do we have time for one more question? I need quick advice here. All right, we're going to take one more quick question, and then I think we have to wrap up. Yes, okay.
Well, what's here? Yeah. Can we hear that there's two hands, we can hear both. And,
yeah.
Okay.
Because there was one of them.
Okay, yes, go ahead.
Okay. My name is Ruth Indek, and I have worked over the years with IRPE, Union for Radical Political Economics. And in my view, and I'm wondering if you agree with this, one of the biggest obstacles to making refugee situations any better into negotiating anything with anybody is the global situation of not anybody having any jobs. Like, you know, like if China were probably, which had the least of an unemployment problem of anybody, is now having factories that are like redundant, you know, having excess capacity all over the place. And if, you know, if the world economy, like if you read the Wall Street Journal, there's like trillions of dollars that nothing's being done with. They don't see any reason to invest in anything that could possibly create jobs. You know, and if people that we know that are college educated and, you know, my friends that went to college with me, if we can't even find jobs, I mean, you know, it seems to me that this is a really, really big part. I mean, it's as big as oil, in terms of an economic underpinning to the problems, you know, of the whole situation right now. So I'm wondering if you agree with that, and if so, I think it should be part of what we talk about, you know, when we talk about this stuff.
Okay. Well, let's
go
there.
Okay. Yeah.
Go for it. You're
in darkness back there.
Yeah, I know. I'm Lisa Gitlin. I live in Red Hook, Brooklyn. If Hillary, this isn't related to the job. Well, of course it's related to the job. If Hillary Clinton is elected president, I was just wondering if you guys were optimistic or pessimistic about her ability to steer us away from some of these bellicose solutions to international conflicts.
All right, this is a really great way to end the evening.
I'll go first, I guess. In terms of the jobs crisis, absolutely, there's a larger economic thing, and that's why I started with that proverb of when there's no snow in the mountains of Afghanistan, people will need to move because there's not an ability to sustain themselves. So that's also a jobs question, that if you can't find jobs. One of the things that I think has happened is with the large number of people on the move as migrant labor, as well as refugees, is one of the things people are forced to leave behind is their rights. So if you sneak across the border, it's far easier for you to be exploited. And so in fact, there's low wage jobs. And so I would just say that what we need to make sure is that folks' rights are not checked at borders, simply because they're fleeing, whether it's for economic reasons, political reasons, persecution, whatever, and that everyone has the right to kind of the human rights around the jobs is a struggle. So thank you for that. On Hillary, her bellicose rhetoric. In the 2008 campaign, she said that if Iran threatened Israel, she would obliterate Iran. I don't know, obliterate kind of sounds like genocide, mass slaughter, carpet bombing. So we need to distinguish between rhetoric, but this is what I would say is always with any politician, it's celebrate when there's something that's said, that's done right, not necessarily just said right, and confront them on the whole iceberg under the water, still continuing the power politics of those that are profiting from the ongoing war and displacement.
The only thing I would add on the jobs issue, I think that it's one of the factors that leads to increased sectarianism. Because one of the things, if you look at, for example, in Syria, where the drought began in earnest in around 2009, there was a several year long drought that forced something like 800,000 farmers off their land. There was no water, they couldn't farm. They flooded the cities looking for work. There wasn't a massive unemployment crisis going on in Syria, but there were not enough jobs for that number of people in a short time. So in that circumstance, what happens is the people who get the few jobs that are available tend to be people who know someone in power or know someone closer to power. That meant that the Alawites, who had been privileged, although it wasn't for religious reasons, but that was the community that was privileged in Syria under the Assad regime, father and son, they were more likely to get the jobs. That increased sectarian resentment and built sectarianism into a country that had not been particularly sectarian in the past. So that was another aspect of it. On the question of Hillary Clinton, I agree. I don't think, the question of could she move towards a more just solution to international crises, I think she could. I think she's someone who has a lot of international clout. I think the problem is I don't see any indication that that's her intention. I see every indication that, particularly being the first woman president, if she became such, she would be very committed to making clear to the U.S. population and the world that she is as tough as any man, and that means as militaristic as any man. And I think that what it goes to, and it goes back to the question about Bernie Sanders as well, for us, I think the fundamental question is not who's in the White House, but what kind of a movement can we build to hold them accountable to what people in this country and around the world need.
I just thank Phyllis, David, and Judy again for being with us, and also to thank the audience for being such a wonderful audience, really. and for your patience with the crowding and so forth and so on. And finally, I want to remind you that Phyllis will be signing books over there. Judy has her CDs that are here. We have petitions to sign. And most importantly, we really need everybody's work and everybody pitching in. So thank you to everybody.